We'll give him a black eye.
That's right.
How's everybody doing today?
Awesome in the Lord.
Amen, amen. Amen. Praise God. Well, where can I start? I just want to say a quick prayer myself here.
Yes.
Heavenly Father, we just come today in the name of Jesus. I lift each one of our hearts today, Almighty God. Let us receive with our hearts, with an open heart and our open spirit. Let us not just hear with our ear, but let us hear with our hearts, Almighty
yes.
God. Let us leave out of here today with a changed heart and not the same way, Almighty God. We accept and we receive your love and your joy and peace, Almighty God. I just place everybody today in the palm of your hands, and those that are not here today, be with them. In Jesus' name.
Amen, Lord.
Thank you. Well, I wanted to talk about my little bit of my testimony, and of course I'm going to share a little bit of the Word of God here. We're going to start with the Matthew. Matthew 25:34. Shall the king say unto them on his right hand, Come ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. So that's what we'll inherit is the kingdom.
Yes.
And Matthew 25:41. Depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, and prepare for the devils and his angels. That's part of my testimony today and the Word of God. We want to inherit the kingdom of God. We're not perfect. And you know, some of us, we think just because we did a little mistake or said something, the enemy comes and he puts this guilty in your mind that you're no good no more, forget it. Don't even say nothing. Keep your mouth shut. You know. But he's a liar. He's a liar. You know, we all learn. We're all learning. We're never going to know it all. Only God knows it all. I want to start from as I was growing up as a kid. I'm going to give you guys part of my testimony of hell, and then I want to go into the testimony about heaven. So, as I was growing up, I was raised and born in California. I don't know if any of you guys know this, but I was raised in California, in East LA, where all the gangs in South Central and nothing but gang violence, drugs, in trouble with the cops, you know. My dad was an alcoholic. I didn't have no discipline with my dad. I had no love. He was always drinking and doing his thing, and he'll come home, he'll beat all of us. He'll throw me out. For some reason, I don't know what he had against me. He always jumped on me. I'm the oldest one from my sister and my brother. We'll only go by 1 year, which is 42, 43, and 44. So we're all in the same month, February 10th, 19th, and 16th. So we're all small, you know. But for one reason, I don't know, my dad would always just get on me. He would always get on me. I tried to get close to him. I wanted to learn how to do mechanic. I wanted to learn things that he knew, but he would always come from my brother. And he would push me away, and he called me that I was dumb, I was worthless, I was kick me for no reason, you know. But you know what? I'm just going to say this. I thank God who I am now. I thank God for forgiving me for everything, okay? I'm not here to say, hey, feel sorry for me or I'm feeling pity for myself. No, 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 no. I'm here thanking God for what he brought me at and the love and the joy that I have, okay? I'm just telling you that this is what I had to go through in order to get to where I'm at now. But I thank God for his help, because without him, we ain't nothing. So yeah, you know, in time I was raised, we're growing up in the neighborhood, I guess what you call it. I had no discipline, I had no love for my dad. My mom was my best friend. She always tried to comfort me, she always tried to help me. Wow. For some reason he would never let us get connected together, and he would always just pick up a fight with her or hit her when he was drunk and throw me out in the streets. He started throwing me out of the streets when I was probably about 9-10 years old. And I didn't know how to, I couldn't get a job. So being raised in the neighborhood, it was nothing but gangs and you know. So that became my family. That's where I learned how to survive. I learned how to make money by selling drugs, by stealing cars, by stealing stereos. The first day I went to jail, I was 10 years old. I was in juvenile hall. Wow. I did 6 months. And from that point on, it was a chain of me getting arrested all the time and also being imprisoned. My dad was locked up half of his life because of his alcohol. So this is how I learned my life in the world. I got involved with drugs, and you know, I just didn't have the love. One day, I guess I came home, and my dad was beating on my mom. And he, you know, I was a little grown up, a little more, I was a little older. He knew he couldn't hit her no more, so I would jump in and try to help her. So then, that was more of his anger towards me, because, you know, he's not going to have his way around the house no more. So, yeah, I helped my mom, and, you know, me and my dad, not that I'm proud of it, but we would fight like we were enemies, like we just met in the street and just start swinging at each other, throwing chairs at each other's head and, you know, just going at it. You know, I'm not proud of it. I'm not. But, you know, for having someone at home like that, that was really dangerous, how can we protect ourselves? What can we do? Are we going to let this man kill me because he was my dad? Or was it because we had to use some kind of wisdom to help, to protect ourselves, right? I mean, we're not just going to let anybody in the streets come and try to take our lives. We're going to use wisdom to get away or do something. So basically, I got him off my mom that night, and he got mad at me. I grabbed him. I threw him against the wall. He flew. He ran to the room. I knew exactly what he was going for. I ran downstairs out of my house, my apartment. I ran all the way downstairs, and I went out on the left-hand side. We were on top of the second floor, and the rail was there. Yeah, a couple seconds before when I went downstairs, he comes out with the rifle. It's a 22, 16-shot rifle. So I'm running, and he's like, pow, 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 just throwing bullets at me. Pow, 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 pow. When I hit the corner, I felt something. Pow, and then I can hear the fence. You can hear the bullets, choo, choo, right? Just, you know, just kind of bounce off of there. So then I kept running because I was scared. I thought he was going to chase me. So I run and I run and I run and I get to this corner. Somewhere I start, you know, I hid. So after a while, my leg starts feeling hot. It's kind of hot and it's itchy. And I'm like, what is going on? I feel wet and it's hot. So I pick up my pants. As you guys can see here, I got hit. He hit me with the rifle. I didn't do anything that day because I didn't call the cops. I was concerned about my mom. And I went back. All I did was put kind of like paper or toilet paper on it. I never went to the doctor or nothing. I just let it heal that way, which is basically just the meat that dried up. So I went back. I was more concerned about my mom. No, I guess he was gone because he got scared. He probably thought he was going to go to jail. And I didn't want to call the cops because I was already in trouble with the law. So I figure if I call the cops, they're going to ask for my name, and then I'm going to go to jail for warrants or whatever I had in my past, you know, because there were so many things in my past. But, yeah, that's the way it was with my dad, you know, and that's why we didn't have no discipline. And also, you know, I used to run away from the house a lot because there was no love at the house, you know. I thank God for that because, you know, you can see kids these days, you know. That's kind of like, if the kid's not at home all the time or the kids don't want to be at home, there's a reason because there's something going on at home. There's no love. There's no joy. There's no peace. There's no attention to that kid. But I was one of those kids. My dad had a family friend. And I'm going to say this with the love of God because you know what? This is one Henry that the enemy had me. This is where the enemy had me. He had a seal in my mouth. He had this guilt over me that if I knew, if I would say something, I felt that I wasn't going to have no friends. No one was going to love me. They were going to think I was gay. But it was from a friend of a family, from my dad's. I was molested as a kid also. And from that point on, I didn't want to say anything. I wanted to commit suicide. I overdosed 3 times on drugs. I wanted to jump out from the roof. I would cut myself. I mean, so many things in my life that I hated myself. And I wanted to say something that was burning me, but I kept holding that in me. So it was just more anger. I was building more anger. So I got older, running with the gang. You get more dumb things in the gang. Trust me, you know, you don't care if you're going to die. You know, you're going to die. You join the family, you're going to die for the family. But not knowing where you was going to go. I had no clue where I was going to go. I knew there was, I guess they called hell, and there was heaven because of the church people that would go around the neighborhood there. And a big bus, they'll come pick us up and, you know, try to come, hey, let's go to church. Nah, I don't want to go to church. Hey, Mario, look, Jesus loves you. You know what? No, thank you, please. Don't talk to me about God. I go, well, you know what? Talk to me when I'm sober. He goes, that's the point. When are you going to be sober? I said, that's my point. I don't want to hear anything about your God. Get away from me with that. But they, you know what? They didn't give up. They didn't give up. They will come, and they will even come knocking in your door. And I don't know if you guys remember those days where people come knocking in your door, and you know, then you hide, you turn off the TV, you close everything, you're looking out the window, are they gone yet? You know, God, they're stubborn, really, you know. Leave. Don't they get what the word no means? You know. And that was us, you know. My sister, my brother, you know, hey. My brother was still smaller, you know, he'd get up, turn on the cartoon and whatnot, and we'll go over there and grab him and throw him in a closet and turn off the TV because he wanted his TV on, you know. So just wait for a little while, you know, they're going to come and then they'll leave. And but yeah, so it went on that way, you know. But anyways, like I said, I was involved with drugs. I did things I didn't want to. But you know what? And Jeremiah says that when God says he had called you before placing in your mother's womb, out of your mother's womb, he has called you. You know, he has a plan for you. And you, let me tell you, I'll stand on that word because he spoke to me just like he did to Jeremiah. So little I knew. I didn't know. My parents were raised Catholic, so I really didn't know anything about Christian or, you know. My point to that was that wherever I would go at night, because I was always wandering at night, I was out up to no good, to hurt people, to rob people. But, you know, sometimes I want to go take off, walk to the other side of the hill, go to somebody else's neighborhood, because I thought I was tough going by myself. But see, some of the times when I wanted to go into different areas, like through the alleys where they were all dark, and I wanted to go in there to make a shortcut, to go get beer, whatever it was, but I would always hear this voice, don't go in there. I'll be walking with a beer or something in my hand, you know. Want to be stubborn to go in there, it'll tell me again, don't go in there. And it'll make me, I'll pause because I'll hear the voice, and it's like, okay, now it's a little deeper now, you know. And then to hear it twice, what's going on? So maybe in a couple more steps, a real deep voice, don't go in there. Okay, now I'm starting to freak out. All right, I'll go the other way. I just wanted to make a shortcut because I didn't want to go all around. So I'll go all around, go back, go up, get my beer, come back down, right there in that alley where I was going to cut through. And I'm coming down from the hill. I see the ambulance, I see cops, everything there. There was a dead body. There was a dead body in the floor there. Somebody had gotten stabbed. And whoever was there was waiting for somebody to cross that alley, for they can take them out. So little things like that, that God was, you know, was speaking to me and showing me, don't go here, don't do that, don't. He was helping me avoid for the enemy to try to take me out, destroy me completely. And, I was already a little more older, and, you know, being in prison didn't help either. You know, you go to prison, you have to do what you got to do in it to survive. You have to do what you got to do to survive. We can say no, but you know what? All that softness, all that love, they ain't going to understand it in prison. And if you're in the world and you're running in the family, they're going to give you a call. They're going to give you something to do in there. So either be killed or kill. You know, but that's the way I learned. I walked, and to me, I didn't know any better. I didn't. You know, I come back. They give me a job to do. I do it. Come back, and I had cigarettes. I had candies. I had commissary to last me for 6 months. That's the way it would pay. But you know what? I thank God because I did. I repent. I repent with everything. With everything. So coming out and whatnot. So finally, you know, walking in the party world and whatnot, my friends, this one night, this Friday, it was a Friday. I was at home and it was Friday, I was getting ready, you know, wanted to come, getting ready to go out with my friends, and just something didn't feel right. Something covered me, like I felt something that covered me. But it was heavy, and it was just heavy in my heart. And I just kept feeling that if I go out, I wasn't going to come back home. And I wanted to answer the door. Part of me, but more like 98% of my heart and me, within me, don't answer that door. You would not come home. So, you know what? I didn't make any noise. I let them bang in the door. Bang, bang, bang. Come on, we know you're in there, blah, blah, blah. I didn't say anything. So I just laid in my couch. Lay back. I had my hair long. I used to, you know, I love that Zeppelin and, you know, go out there to the Oz Festival and, you know, all these rock concerts, you know, Motley Crue, Scorpions, all these guys. That's how I grew up. And I got myself, of course, into some satanic stuff that I didn't even realize it was satanic, you know. And I used to love playing a lot of the Ouija board. And, yeah, trust me, people are like, well, really? You know, yeah, it's real. The thing will move by itself after you move your hand out of that. And then you opened up demonic doors and things will start going more worse than you know. I mean, a lot of people, you got stories on that, and you know, people like, oh yeah, you know, it'll come back to you, and you know, you got to burn it or whatever, you know. So hearing these stories, that's what got me. You know what? Let me try it. So, yeah, it's true. You know, whatever you open in the spirit, it's demonic, and it would follow you, and it will follow you. And burning black candles, and you know, getting myself and stuff like that because of my pain, of my hurt. I wanted power, but I didn't know what kind of power I was getting into. I wanted to control everything. I wanted the drugs. I wanted girls. I wanted new cars. Keep walking with a big fat pocket in. That's all I wanted. I wasn't afraid to die. I wasn't. Because when you have a heart with so much hate, and it's so crushed, you don't care about whether you die or not. But so little I knew where I was going. So, you know, I just kept moving and doing what I wanted to do. And, you know, I would cut myself. And I marked the 666 on the wall with my blood and do the pentagram, satanic pentagram. And I will worship it and do this and do that. You know, we'll get together with other people that I knew and we'll do circles and, you know, just the whole, I don't want to get into that because God deserves the glory and I give him the glory, not the enemy. I rebuke him. But long story short, after that, when I was at home, and I didn't want to go outside. And I laid there. After my friend stopped knocking, I laid there. I remember the time. It was about 9:30 p.m. I laid on my couch. Turned off the TV because I started to feel real tired. Sleepy. And finally, I just fell asleep, I guess. So then I opened my eyes. As soon as my eyes closed, I opened my eyes again, and I noticed that my face was stuck in the ceiling. I was stuck, and I can see my body sideways, just the way I lay there asleep, see my hair long all the way down to the floor. So I'm wondering myself, how come I can see my body? So you know how you have a balloon, but you know, and you know, you let it go, and it bounces up and down the ceiling. So I push myself down with my hand. And I float down halfway, and I go up, and I start bouncing again. So within me, I'm questioning myself. Okay, what's going on? How come I can see my body? When I said it the third time, I start spinning little by little on the ceiling. I start going around. So there's nothing on the ceiling for me to grab onto. So, you know, I'm trying to grab onto something, but I can't. So I'm just kind of floating different direction. My body's starting to just kind of move. And I'm going faster and faster and faster and faster. And as fast as I'm, as fast as I was going, I could start hearing demons. I didn't know if it was demons, but to know now, I know there were demons because I can hear the way the voice, the last was. It was really wicked. Just wicked. Just laughing. And I'm going so fast that, you know, and suddenly, I don't, in the movies, you know, you guys seen Back in the Future and all that, you know, and it goes, those time machines, whatnot. So that's what I hear. And I find myself in this, everything's so dark. The sand was like real dirty gray. Whatever was behind me, I couldn't look back, but there was a light behind me that was guiding me. That was allowing me to see all these things. And I can see trees, burnt trees, real dead. I mean, you think that tree there looks dead? No. These trees look 10 times dead. I mean, burnt. And I remember I was moving forward. And then I see this big black tunnel in front of me. You can hear the tunnel. You can hear it like real wicked. You can hear it. And then I see five demons. They were in front of me, side of me, behind me, around in a circle. And they were covered, almost like witches and warlocks that they like to cover themselves. They were covered, but you can see their fingernails real long. You can see some of them had real long noses like rats. Their eyes look green, red, yellow, but a very evil, wicked color. And just by them looking at you, you can feel such an like the hate off of these things. So much hate. I mean, overwhelming hate. You know, maybe some of us can see people that, you know, okay, I know he don't like me. I mean, we can just tell by looking at someone. But no, you can feel the hate out of these things. That it was so overwhelming in your heart. So what I caught my attention was that when I was moving forward to this tunnel, I can see a little light way in the end of the tunnel. So I'm questioning myself, what am I doing here? Where am I? And I can see these demons. And it's almost like they can read your thoughts. They know your thoughts. And I wanted to know where I was at, but they wouldn't answer me. They just keep laughing at me, like, just laughing. And one thing that caught my attention is that I wasn't moving. I couldn't feel my feet moving. So I happened to look down, and I was in the air. I was gliding, and I had shackles on my feet, and I had shackles in my hand. I mean, these shackles were chains and just real big, heavy balls, you know. And I wanted to put my hands down, and I couldn't. I had to carry those shackles with me. I wanted to move, and I couldn't. Whatever it was that was holding me, that was controlling me, I could not move at all. So I'm gliding. I'm in the air, and I'm gliding. I'm going forward. Now I'm entering this tunnel. As I'm going into this tunnel, halfway of this tunnel, I can start, the smell starts to come out. And the smell is terrible. I mean, let me tell you, when I grew up, when I was coming up in the neighborhood out there, we would smell, and because there were bodies dead, or covered over trash. I mean, the smell of a dead body, I don't know if you guys ever smelled a dead body. I mean, I can still smell that here. It's bad. Yes. Yes. But this smell here was the smell of burning flesh. It was overwhelming for your heart, for yourself. I mean, if we smell something, a dead body, if you're inside a room and a dead body's there, and there's no air, you're going to get sick. Your body's going to get sick. But this thing was over. I was already getting sick. I wanted to die. But I couldn't die. All I know is that I kept putting my head down because that's the only thing I can move. So as I go forward, finally come to the end of this tunnel, and the little light is gone. So within myself, I'm like, well, as soon as I get to the end of that tunnel with that light at, I'm going to be safe. But that light was gone. So I'm standing there finally, and I'm kind of looking around like, okay, everything's dark, pitch black. And this fire just came out of nowhere in front of me. High, real high. And I can feel my face like it's just melting, like the heat. And I'm screaming and I'm screaming and I'm screaming. Okay, that was no joke no more. That was no game to me. Inside, I was still going through this little, like I'm going through a museum, a park, like just in a ride, just enjoying the view. No. Now reality starting to hit me when I feel this fire hitting me. So then the fire splits open in half. Like, you know, you open your curtains in the morning. It opens and splits. And a voice tells me, go in there. And then when I go through this fire, I mean, it wouldn't touch me. It just, I went right into the middle of it. When I go to the other side of this fire, it's almost like the whole thing just changed in there. The view, the everything just changed. Like going through a door. I went through a door, basically. But it was a fire. When I went through this, I mean, that's where I seen a lot of people. A lot of people burning, shouting, screaming. There was like dirt roads, like with rocks. And I mean, real ugly. Ugly dirt roads, and you know, just could see kind of like blood, or almost like kind of like body parts, like guts and blood. And so I'm going through this road, and I can see on my right hand side, I see this big long river. But this river, it was nothing but fire, and I couldn't see anything yet, but just fire. You know, if you put gasoline in a little hole and you know, cracked, you could see just the fire. But as I was going, you could start seeing these little tiny eyes, these little kind of skeleton things looking at you. But you could hear a lot of scream, though, a lot of scream. And I believe Mary Kay Baxter mentioned about being changed up. There was rivers. Well, that's what got me, because I seen this river of fire, and I seen that it was homosexuals and lesbians together on this. They were chained up together. It's almost like if you're in the water, you need to come up for air, but there's no way out of the pool because you just got to keep swimming or walking into that water. That's the way it was with this fire. There's no way out no more. Those shackles, those chains they had, they're so overwhelming, they're so heavy, you can't get out. And even if you tried, there's demons that stand on the side of this thing and poke you and throw you back in there. I kept going and kept going. See, it says in the Word of God, you will not understand it now, but you'll understand it later. And I wasn't even a Christian yet when God showed me this place. But after, everything came to an understanding. What it was, what it meant, because it's in the Word of God. So in my left-hand side, I seen there was like jails. And I recognized that because being locked up half of my life. And there was doors actually looked like prisons, but in hell that you got prisons too. And it all depends on your sin, or what you did on your sin, what you did in your past. What is it that you've done in your past that you have not repented to God, that you have not really let go of your heart? All these things, there were even people in there that they said that, yeah, I asked for forgiveness, but they still carried everything in here. They still didn't let go of that past, of that sin that hunted them down for the rest of their lives, which we're talking about that spirit of fear. But these were different jails. And everybody had their portion. Everybody had their different torment in there. Demons will go in there, and I mean, these things are huge. And our carnal minds will be like, oh, I'll overrun them, and I'll box them, and I'll fight them. No, you cannot move one muscle with these things. If these things want, they can grab your whole body with one hand, and just squeeze you and tear you apart, and throw you against the wall, do whatever they want. You can't run anywhere. There's nowhere to go. One thing I know that I remember that they were asking for water, because there's no rest. And here it says also Lazarus was asking for the rich, for the poor man, dump your fingers and let him pour some drop of water in my tongue. There's no rest. There's no sleep. There's no food. Just torture. One thing I also that caught my attention was there was about that big maggots, worms that go through your bones, that go through your flesh. Your flesh burns completely, and it burns and it burns and it burns. And as it's burning, your pieces of your flesh are going, they're falling, and it burns. And then your skeleton turns nice and black and toasty. I mean, now you're just, and what happens is that once this flesh is gone also, you can see more of the maggots are going through your bone, through your skull. But it's almost like you're being alive. That's how you're feeling it. So it grows back. The flesh starts growing back again. And then the flames start again. And it just constantly. And then I've seen demons. Demons going in through these cells. They go in and they sexually abuse you. Torture you, rip your head off, rip your arms off, sexually, in any which way. And that sexually thing that kept coming to me, and I seen it when the Word of God says, if the right hand causes you to sin, cut it off, or is it better than your whole flesh, your whole body goes to hell? Throw that hand in the fire. And I believe that Pastor speaks about that. He preaches about that a lot too. And that was people that were so caught up in masturbation, pornography. They don't get caught up with women or get married. They just, that's a sin, that's a bondage that they're in. So they had their portion in there. They had that. And you see these big long worms like snakes that go in and out of their private parts day and night. They got this metal part in their mouth where it doesn't allow them to do anything. But this metal, it controls their jaw. Where it opens it up and closes it, where these long things go in through their mouth as well, and it's demons also go in there, abuse and maggots and stuff going out through their mouth, and they continue to poke them in their private part. So they're just being tortured, they're, you know, day and night. There were some of them also. The next cell was what I seen was a witch that was sitting there, and she was rocking a chair. I didn't know she was a witch first because there was nothing but fire. But all I know is that when she looked out towards the window, it was a little old lady in a black hoodie. And the word said, witch, over her head, said witch. And she thought that by serving Satan, she was going to have control of the kingdom of the devil. Because witches and warlocks feel that when they go there, they're going to become servants of Satan. They're going to be demons flying around serving Satan. But that's a lie. They're just being in. And once you're dead, you go in there, you're going to be tortured. They're going to do whatever they want with you. Devil was a liar. He's a liar. That spirit of fear, too. Some of us that when we're at home or whatever we're doing, that there's a fear that come over us. This fear. Worries. See, God didn't call us to be worried. And let me tell you, I thank God for something. My mom used to worry a lot. And let me tell you, I was worried. My wife's back there. And let me tell you, when I came in here, in this church, I was delivered. I was delivered. It's something that the Lord brought to my attention. You have to break that chain because it comes from your mother. And I would worry for everything. Texting my kids, are you guys okay? Texting her, are you guys okay? You know, just this, and it almost felt like a disease. It's like overwhelming. I couldn't take it no more. So I had to be delivered from it. And let me tell you, I've been delivered. I've been delivered, you know. I thank the brothers and sisters here for their words of wisdom and knowledge and encouragement. Sister Chris, there ain't. Get up in the morning and say, God, they're in your hands. Not my worried. Hey, you know what? I get up. They're in your hands, God. And I just go through my day with such an amazing love. And, you know, since I've been here, this amazing love has been over my heart. Just, I mean, I was married for 16 years, you know, serving God. And she went her own way. But you know what? It's not about her, and I'm not going to talk wrong about her. I forgive her. I'm not going to let the enemy put that poison in my heart. Okay? I pray for her salvation, that she will come back to Christ one day. All I know is that my love with God now, I have it, and I'm going to continue to move forward in serving God with my kids and my new wife, and I thank God for my new wife over there. Like I said, we just got married July 11th, and I thank God for that. But anyway, back into the pits of hell. We walk, you know, and some of these things I said, Mary K. Bachelor already has spoken about, and it is true. I mean, this place is real. There's people saying, I want out now. I would do exactly what you want me to do. I will serve you. I will speak of you. And thank God for this one, because when I was also walking, there was these fires. It was like a line, but it wasn't a river. It was just a wall of fire. And I seen a lot of little hands sticking out. Just hands. And the hands were bleeding. They're just blood dripping out of their hands. A lot of hands just on line, just going down the line, going down the line. So I'm kind of, okay, what are the, to me, it was like, well, okay, they're probably asking, they want out. Pull them out of there, right? Well, in my thoughts, in my voice came, these are the hands, because my children does not speak of me. This is the blood in their hands. They had opportunity to speak of God. They had opportunity to let God know about, let people know about Jesus. And they wouldn't say nothing. Even if their heart's getting ready to pop out of the chest, they will hold it and not say nothing about Jesus. So it's part of our job. It's part, I mean, if we're in with God completely, we're going to be in completely and do His work and move forward for God. Don't just let God halfway. That's why us as the body, we need to love each other like God loves us. You know?
Yes.
Let's not, well, do I have to invite the brother for dinner or my place? Well, you know what it says here, I love your neighbors as I love. I guess. You want to go to dinner? You know? No. If we're going to invite each other, hey, come on in, my brother. Come on in. I love you. Come on. And if you know if your brother needs help and he ain't got no food, not just only invite him for dinner. Hey, here's a sack of rice. Here's the can of this. Bless him. Send him off. You know, it's better to give than to receive. So, you know, God wants you to invite Him to His house completely. He wants to come in, take His sandals off, sit in your recliner. Like, man, this is my house for reals. This is my house of prayer. My love is in this house. My child invited me here. You know what? This is something that I learned from God. This is when God spoke to me about that. You know what I'll do when I sit down and eat some bread? I put one for God right there. Father, you're invited to my table. I want to eat bread with you because I love you and I thank you. I know the bread is not probably going to be eaten, but you know what? It's for you, Father. It's right there. Lord, I'll move out of my seat here. This is your recliner right here. Sit down. This is your house. That's the love that we have for God. And that's the love that He wants us to all to have, even for your neighbors, because there's people down there that it's just so hard for people to love. Even their neighbors. You know? Instead of talking about your neighbor, instead of talking about your brother and sister, pray for them. Hey, sister, guess what? Did you hear about the neighbor? Hey, you know what? How about we pray for them better? I don't want to gossip. How about we pray for them? And I'll pray for you too if you need prayer. I get a lot of people from work. Hey, you know what? This and that. How about we pray for them? And then I can pray for you for you can God, take that gossip off your mouth. Well, I guess I ain't going to be talking to you. Thank you. But see, this is also the people that was in there. Because they wouldn't let God in all the way completely in. They were halfway. They were lukewarm. And we're going to let God in, let them all the way in. But as I kept going by, and there are all these cells, there was different. He didn't show me all, almost, you know, He didn't show me everything like He did Mary. But He showed me, because when I went to bed, when I fell asleep, it was 9:30. When I was up, when I jumped out of with my body, it was about 10 o'clock. So it was probably about 30 minutes. What you're seeing in the spirit out of your body, it seemed like I was there like forever. It felt like I was gone forever. And only for those 30 little minutes that I was gone? No. I had enough. I had enough. It says, and with God, God will not give you no more than what you can take. He knew what I could take. So that's why He showed me that portion of hell. So as I kept going, everything started fading behind me. I couldn't hear the screams no more. I could just see the little bit of whatever these demons, little small demons, big demons, running around. They got these big swords. They have swords in their hands. Real big, sharp swords. And I'll tell you another thing that just the Lord just brought to my attention was when I came to this room, this one big room, there was a lot of demons dancing around. You could hear rock and roll music, guitar. It was jamming, just boom, jamming, guitar, drums. But see, they were not singing the songs that we hear in the world. They were praising Satan. Ooh. Satan is our God. Ooh. Satan is our God. And you can just hear the music getting louder and louder. And just they were just praising this lying devil.
That's a bad devil right there.
And when they were moving around in circle, I noticed that they were not close as a circle. There was an open circle. In the middle of that circle, there was a coffin. And as they were going around, singing and praising their God, they kept poking this coffin because they had a hole, like almost like in the center of their heart. And every time they're going by, they kept poking it and poking it and poking it. And you can hear a man in there. And he was screaming. He was shouting. He was saying, no more, no more, please, no more. I mean, the scream, it touches you here. You wish you can save everything that you've seen. Just like we wish we can save all the hungry kids that we see on the streets right now, starving. But there's so much that we can do. So they were poking this coffin. And like I said, God knows your thoughts before you think them. And what's going on in there? And the words came to me. He used to be a pastor. And it says in the Word of God, they have robbed me of my tithing. So that was his torture there. He had luxury, he had money, he had cars, he had Rolex, he had...
Wow.
So what was this pastor doing in his lifetime? And not only that, I mean, we have to give God also our tithing. You know, I mean, it doesn't matter, you know. God understands you got to pay your bills. But let me tell you, when you give your complete tithing, because God's a king, he's not a waitress. We got to give, we got to bless him. And a lot of people, that's the majority of the people. Oh, well, you know what, all these churches want money. All these churches want this. So they won't go to church because they feel they're going to have, they're going, all they want is their money. But see, in order to give to God, we got to love God first. To know and what he can do. Yeah, he'll bless you because he already knows what you need. But as long as we keep sowing seed for the kingdom of God, let me tell you, this church here, it's good soil. This is good soil, let me tell you. And God has been opening some doors. And not to give because, Lord, I want a big house. No. Lord, this is for your kingdom. You know the rest. I know later it'll come, but right now, what do you want me to do for your glory? Just continue to bring me the lost, the broken, and the sick so that I can minister and lay hands and pray for them. And the rest, it'll start flowing. But there was people in there because they have robbed God of their tithing and they don't want to give. You know, if you guys are struggling, well, I only got 50 bucks in my pocket. Well, you're going to pay your house payment with 50 bucks? You're going to pay your bill with the $50? So why not trust God with it? Long story short, it happened to me. I was, when I was married, we were in need. I lost my job. I had 50 bucks in my pocket. I think it was our gas or water or something, I can't remember. But it was an $800 bill that was getting ready to get shut down.
Wow.
The only thing we were waiting for is Monday, that bill. Okay, we're coming down, man, you know? So that service, I remember. I said, Lord, I need help. And I didn't tell anybody about this. No one. What can I do? And the Holy Spirit spoke to me. Give that last 50. You think I'm going to complain to him? I didn't complain. I said, no problem. Boom. Not too late. There was somebody standing in front of me with collecting offering. I got it. I said, in Jesus' name, it's yours. I went back to my seat. I started praising God. I started singing to God. The Holy Spirit fell on me. I said, thank you for what you've done. Next thing you know, Monday came. The bill came in the mail. My ex got it. Here, you open it. I don't want to see it. I said, sure, I'll open it. I said, God, it's yours. I opened it up. I looked at it. Guess what it said? Thank you for your recent payment. In the bottom, zero balance, $800.
Glory! Glory!
I didn't tell nobody. Nobody knew about my bill. It was just between God and I.
That's God.
Thank you for the recent payment, zero balance. Oh, now she was happy. Now she was like, ooh, praising God. Yeah.
Come out.
Not to talk wrong about women. Women, you guys are awesome. But you know what? Keep your minds out of the finance. Stop trying to think you're going to fix everything. Give it to God. I'll tell you this for her. I love you, honey. No. Let's trust. Trust. These are true miracles. These are true blessings that God's done. You guys try to put all this together. You're trying to add all this together. You're not going to do it on your own. And getting mad, it's not going to help either. Not to be mean, but why do you think sometimes we just kind of, we're numb? You guys are, we're just numb. You're not going to respond to me? You're not going to say nothing? What do you want us to say? When there's a head in the house and we go by faith, hey, God spoke, he's going to do it, leave it alone. Why are you putting your hands in there? Leave it alone. It's going to come to pass. I told my wife when we got that house, we're in a bigger house. You know, she's a little stressed when God said we moved in there. When I started praying, I seen a vision of us coming in and out of the house. It's going to happen. God's going to get us in there. So she's like, okay. I stand and I believe. God. Next thing you know, we got the phone call. Hey, come and get the place. It's yours. Because it's why God says the head and not the tail. We're the head and not the tail. Now, if you see these things happening when the man speaks it out and it comes to pass, just, hey, honey, pray, because I know if God speaks to you, it's going to happen. Let's try not to. Don't get all bunched up on this. Just leave it to God. Leave it. And praise and rejoice. I'm telling you, the most thing is when you can praise and praise God is when you're going through the hard times. I know it's not hard. I know it's not easy. It's not. But praise him. And you will see that breakthrough. Because it says through your breakthrough, through your praise is the breakthrough of your storm. But as I was coming out, back out to this, when finally came to the end of this tunnel, there was an angel, a big tall angel. And I seen this angel twice. Just like I see these angels that stand here. Earlier today, there's an angel standing right there again. There's another angel standing there. In the stairway, there was a big box here of light, and some stairs started to come down. Because this is what they do here. And this is what they do. They stand to minister your heart, to prepare you, to release it and give it to God. Don't fear what the devil, about me talking about hell, don't fear it. But fear God. Because he's the one that can destroy the body and the soul. So all we have to do is like, Lord, fix me. Help me to love. I mean, you know, from Reno, Nevada, I was in Reno. And I'm not going to glorify myself or put myself up. But you know, when the love of God's in you, I will stop everywhere I see people hungry. Buy them McDonald's or anything. Don't give them money because you're sowing bad seed. But if you got time, pull over. Go to McDonald's. Pull over. Take out your Bible. You know what? We stank once. The ones in the street, hey, they might stink because they're homeless. They ain't got no water to clean themselves. But we stank before God forgave us. We were full of sin and we stank. But let me tell you, God says, I love you, my son. Come here. I can do something good with you. So those people, you know what? I go. Here's the bag. I minister to them. You know what? Come here. I love you. Just cry to them. So as I was at the end of this tunnel, there was a big angel. He had a sword in his hand. And as I was already scared. I was already afraid. I didn't want to move anymore. I couldn't still turn back. I couldn't look back. But all I know is that I was already crying. I just wanted out, out. And this angel said, Mario, Mario. And he called me through a spiritual name as well. And he said again, Mario. And I looked up to him. He says, look at me. And this big sword, it was just full of fire. It lit up the whole place. When this fire came out, and I came closer, he came closer with the sword, this peace came over me. And he said, who is the name of your God? And I looked and I said, he goes, do you know where you're at? I said, no. He said, do you know that if today was your time, this would be your portion? This is hell. You're in hell. He said, if today it was your call, this is where you spend eternity. He says, who's your God? And I said, so you know, a little window opened up. And I remember Ronnie and Mike, the church people, the ones that used to go knocking at the door, the one that used to come up to me and say, hey, look at brother, look what the Bible says, Jesus loves you. When they came up to me and I seen this little window opened up in that picture, a video was rewind, he's like, look at brother Mario, Jesus loves you. The window closed. Whew. The angel said to me, who is your God? I said, Jesus. He said, scream it out. Scream it out. And I said, Jesus, real loud. Jesus. And it echoed. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And that's when I came into my body. When I came into my body, I kind of sat and I couldn't breathe. I was catching my breath. I was trying to catch my breath. And I knew I was sitting in a dark room in my living room. It was dark. The lights were right there. I didn't want to move. I didn't want to move one muscle because I didn't know these things were around me. So the first thing that came to my mind was drop to your knees. And I dropped to my knees. And I got up and I said, I remember those words. Jesus, forgive me. I repent of all of my sins, I said. I repent. I don't want to go to hell. And when I said those words, this buzzing little noise came from the inside of my feet. It was like bzzz, and then like choop, out of my head. Let me tell you, I did not want alcohol. I didn't want to. I couldn't stand the alcohol, the tobacco, or drugs. I was delivered from everything. Everything. And that point is when God said, you're forgiven. And all I want to do is just serve God, serve God. So then I moved forward. I started moving forward with God. And I started doing, and he started speaking to me. He started setting us, or showing me in dreams. He started speaking and speaking, preparing my heart, pulling every root out of my heart. He started bringing people that real servants of God to teach me to walk, to be like them. You know, because baby Christians, we're still kind of like, oh, you know, girls will come by, you still want to kind of lust and stuff. But you know what? But when I got delivered, I didn't want nothing with that. I learned to give my heart to God completely because of what I have seen. I did not want to go. I didn't want to go to hell just by lusting. My heart wasn't in that. My heart was just nothing but God. I just want God. I want God. So this would happen from California. Then I left, came back, got married, and I was still walking. I was still walking with God. Still walking with God. I was growing spiritually. I joined a church called Jesus Christ Spirit-Filled in Reno, Nevada. And that's where I started growing. That's when the prophet came also and said, this is what God's going to do for you. You have the same gift I do, he said. God is calling you prophetically. You're going to bring a lot of people to the glory of God. And then would they just continue to pray for me? Continue to pray. I kept walking faithful. I joined every prayer meeting, every men's ministry group. Because over there, there was this place called Churchill, where all men go gather and we go search for God and pray for God in the middle of the desert out there. It was beautiful at night. And just searching, just getting involved with everything I can with for God. We would pray, all men would pray together, and next thing you know, I'll close my eyes and I'll serve and worship God with just everything I had. And then on a Sunday, God will show me a vision where a lot of angels are going down, falling into their knees. And I can hear a lot of trumpets blowing. Trumpets, trumpets. And the words will come to me and say, the king is coming. The king is coming. And I didn't know much about the interpretation of the tongues yet. But I will say, let it go. Let the message go. The king is here, I'll say. And then they'll release. But see, little things like that, in my spiritual walk, I started learning, and God started showing me things. God started, the more thing that he started using me in a mighty way was bringing the lost and the souls to give me my spiritual eyes. Because if we don't have spiritual eyes, then how can we discern anything? How can you see anything? You know, like the pastor says, the spirit quickens. So in 2004, it says, let's go into Revelation 12. Okay, let's do Revelation 21:7. He that overcomes shall... Okay, I'm sorry. Revelation 19:14. And the armies which were in heaven follow him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. The reason I brought this, and also where it speaks here about the gates of pearls, and every sealed gate was of pearl. Every place, and even it says in the Word of God, it says where even the streets are made out of gold. There's mountains of gold. In 2004, matter of fact, this is a journal that I found, and I was asking God, help me find this journal, because I have so many journals that the Lord spoke to me, telling me to write everything he was showing me. And this is, and what I was about to, and what I ministered today, what I'm talking about, I mean, I got other journals, but what a coincidence that this is the one that popped up, because this is what I was going to speak about today. So I found it. So it was actually on the 12 or 23 of 04 when the Lord sent an angel to my house. And it was a very beautiful big angel. And I speak here when he took me up to the spirit, in my spirit, and took me straight to the heavens. And it was about 4:30 a.m. in the morning. I was asleep. And next thing you know, I'm in deepest sleep already. So then I'm laying there, and I start hearing this voice. And this voice was very beautiful, calm, peace. It said, Mario, Mario, Mario. And I'm kind of, okay, I'm opening my eyes real slow here. And I can see a real bright light in the corner of my room. Bright light. So I'm opening my eyes more and more, and he's waking me up. And the same angel I seen in hell with that sword, it was that same angel. Real tall, about 7 foot long, beautiful blonde hair, white garment, big sandals. And he looks at me. He says, Mario. And so I'm up. And he goes, you have been sent by God. You have an appointment. And next thing you know, it was like, poof. That's all I felt. And I'm shooting up to the heavens. And I can look down at my house, and I can see my family. My kids are asleep in the room, and I can see my ex-wife asleep. So in my thoughts, God said he knows your thoughts before you think them. And I'm starting to worry, and he says, fear not, my son. They're safe with me. So I shot. Boom. So I get up to the heavens, and there's this huge cloud in front of me. Huge cloud. And this beautiful angel, I call them angels. I mean, not the ones Mary Kay Baxter was talking about. Those angels are angels that will clear this room if they were here. But when we go home, we become servants out there. That's why we are servants here. Because we're here also to serve each other, to serve people. Because up there, you become servant. You think our work is done here? We still got more work when we go home. So this beautiful young angel came out, white garment, and I never seen any angels out there that look like people that have wings. I had never seen that. But I knew that when she came out of this cloud, she had this beautiful smile. This peace and love came out of her. And she was going like this. She never said nothing to me. She just kind of... So what quickened me was that it says in the Word of God, be careful because Satan comes as a beautiful angel. So then I had to kind of pause. And then the Spirit of God just hit me. I was like, that was from God. That is from God. So I walked in through the cloud. I went straight into it. Not too deep in there, but as soon as I went through the cloud, I seen the most beautiful, beautiful. I mean, the gates, in front there was gates. I mean, I don't even think I ever seen that gold here on the earth. This gold is, I mean, it is so shiny and solid. And then on the gates, it had pearls, it had rubies. It was full of jewels. So as I go into the gate, on my left-hand side, there's other angels. There's a lot of benches, and these benches were made out of pearls. I'm talking about real pearls. So you can see a lot of, I can say probably people that came to me was people that had just gone home, that were sitting on these benches with white garments. And I can see this one angel that's standing there, and he's still ministering the Word of God to them. He's kind of preaching to them. There's a Bible in front of him. He's preaching to them. So I seen that. And then when I looked in front of me, on my right-hand side, there was this huge mountain. Big, big mountain. And, I mean, this mountain was nothing but gold. Gold, gold. Solid, beautiful gold. And you can see the light, the shining that's coming out of this mountain because there's nothing but light over there. Nothing but light. And on my left-hand side, there was another mountain, but it was silver. Not solid, pure silver. Beautiful, beautiful. So I'm walking forward, and I remember that there's rivers of living water, just beautiful rivers, pure crystal clear rivers. And I can see angels, like this one beautiful angel, this woman that's sitting right next to the rivers. She has her hand in the water, and she just has this big smile, like this amazing love. I mean, this is the love there, it's overwhelming. I mean, it's so beautiful. And I remember when I walked in, these angels, there was four of them that greeted me. They had this smile, and they hugged me. And I just wanted to cry because the love was so, my heart, I mean, it was no hate, there was no, you can't feel nothing. But you're pure, your spirit is pure. And full of love and joy and peace, just what God speaks here. He says, "If I died on the cross for your pain and your worries and your, so why can't you just receive that here to walk in that love?" And you know, but it was very overwhelming up there. And then there was a lot of trees, big trees that were lined up, and they would go as far as I can see. And these trees they have a lot of fruit. There was a lot of fruit in these trees. And the green, the color and everything up there, those colors are not even here. You will not find those colors here. Because why? Because you're seeing things in the spirit. And when you see things in the spirit, you see things clearly. You see things more beautiful. And that's why up there, those colors that you have up there, they don't have them here. Or the gold. Or the rubies. You know, I heard testimonies about how people have found God sends brimstones to them, to their churches, and they have brought out these boxes about with brimstones, and I guess they can't sell them because there's no price in God's jewels. So they can't do anything but save them. But everything that you see up there, it's you will never see here in the earth, never. And I seen this big, big, big sandbox. A big, beautiful sandbox. And the swings, there were swings. The swings were made out of gold. The sandbox, I mean, the little kind of like a swing thing, it was kind of crystal. It was made out of crystal. And they had the slide made out of gold. I mean, everything's made out of gold and everything, of silver. And this big playground, there was like hundreds of little kids, little garments. And there's like four angels standing in each sandbox. And they're just watching them. And these little kids are playing. They're just playing. They're just rejoiced. And these are the words that came to me. Some of them were taken. And some of those were because of abortions. And we have heard this many times, that they're waiting for the mama to take care of them. But that's where the repentance is, to repent. Because we still, God's so merciful and lovable that it says, you know, I remember your sins no more. But all these babies, so many babies, they were just happy. And everything I seen was so rejoiced and so lovable that, you know what? I know it's hard for us to say, you know what, I'm going to miss her. That was my kid or my wife, or, you know. But let me tell you, if they can come back and tell you, don't cry. If they can come back and tell you, what does it say? You rejoice, because I'm home. And let me tell you, it's home. They're so happy. I mean, it's just amazing. It's amazing. It's beautiful. And as I kept walking into the sandbox, and then suddenly I see this, it's called, it was like a temple. And I seen God's throne. It was a big solid throne. I didn't see God on the throne, but I seen a big solid throne. Solid gold. And there was angels falling. They were falling to their knees. And they started blowing trumpets. You could hear trumpets from all over the place. And they started screaming again, the king is coming, the king is coming. So then I see this light coming at me as I'm standing there. Big bright light. I couldn't really see anything. But as it was getting closer to me, I could see this real tall man, white garment, his sandals. I can see him from here and down, just like Mary Kay described him, with the beard, his hair up to here. And I couldn't see his face, his eyes, but I knew that when he got close to me, I fell in the presence of God. And I was overwhelming with joy, with love. I mean, the love I just keep saying love because it's so amazing. So he tells me to stand up. And the voice that I hear within us when we pray and God speaks, that's His voice. Because I recognize the voice. It says, our sheep know His voice. So then I'm standing there. And He looks at me. And He speaks to me like He did to Jeremiah. He says, I have called you before placing you in your mother's womb and out of your mother's womb. He said, my son, let my people know that I'm coming. Let my people know that my angels and I are at the gate. He says, let them know there's a heaven and there's a hell. He says, fear not, worry not what they think, because the rest is in the palm of my hand. I'm going to move you into the nations, and wherever I take you, take your feet, you're going to deliver my word. I have ordered me a prophet, and you're going to move, and I will put the words in your mouth, and you will speak them. He says, go and let my people know that I'm coming and that there is a hell and that there's a heaven. And I want them home with me. I didn't want to come back. He knew my thoughts. He said, my son, it's not your time yet. He said, soon you'll be home with me. He said, you'll be home. You'll see me again. He says, but right now, I need you to go and let them know that I love them and I don't want them to go to hell. And then he placed his big hand over my forehead. He went, boom. And I just went back. And, I mean, I fell hard into my body. I mean, just by me looking down, I can see it, and I just went straight into it. Boom. And I got up out of bed. And I was rejoicing. I was full with so much of the Spirit of God. I couldn't wait because I had to go to work. I couldn't wait to go and tell everybody about what I have seen and the experience that I had with God that day. Where I started working, God gave me this job. And this job, it was called the Sportsman's Warehouse. we helped them build it from floor ground up, which is almost like a Kabbalah's here. But everybody in that building was nothing but Mormons. Let me tell you, everybody, when I left from there, when God moved me out of there, everybody had came to know the truth and accepted Jesus for who he was and who, because they had no clue where they were going. And from that point on is when God just started moving me, giving me words of wisdom. And that's when he brought me in 2007. He brought me here to Kansas City, Missouri. We had a good job. We had, you know, but that was not even the situation. I didn't care what I had. The only thing I cared was to be used by God. We had a brand new house. We had a job. We had a good job, everything. And I said, Lord, I don't care about this. You just speak to me. Let me know. What do you need me to do? Where do you need me? I want to just fulfill my Father's glory, I said. We bought a house. Nice house. Better be careful what you tell God. Because let me tell you, we only even lived in there for about 3-4 months. When God spoke to me one morning, I was sitting down. Holy Spirit said, I need you in Kansas City. I was like, what? I need you in Kansas City. Go get boxes. So, you know, I'm like, I run out the door and I said, hey, I'll be back. She's like, where are you going? I said, God needs us in Kansas City. I'm going for boxes. And she's like, what? So I shoot. I go to Walmart and come back with boxes. See, through our obedience, it's action speaks louder than words. I said, okay. Okay, Lord. I kept planting seed. I keep planting seed because the Lord kept telling me, plant seed, plant seed. Trust me, trust me, trust me. I would wake up having dreams that we're already in. We had the U-Haul truck, or we were driving in the way. My ex would wake up too, say, "Hey, you know, I had a dream last night that we were in Kansas City." So I called my brother over here and I said, "Hey, you know, my brother's not really a Christian, but you know, he was more excited to have us because we had no family over there, it was just us." I said, "Can you help me find a house over there because you know, God's calling me out there." And so he uses his my sister-in-law. She's out there searching for houses in a church and whatnot. So that number, that year was 2007. We got to also pay attention for the signs because God uses numbers as well. Number 7 was all over us that year. I mean, 7 everything. 7 here, 7 there. So, okay, we finally got our truck. I said, Lord, I've been planting seed for you. I don't care. Help us. Get us out there. He says, my son, you have the gift of faith, but you need to trust me. I said, okay. We packed up everything. I said, Lord, how am I going to get there? We gave everything to you. He says, trust me. We've got the U-Haul truck. We had $100 in our pocket, okay? They didn't even leave Nevada yet. When we put gas in the U-Haul truck and the $100 were gone. Keep driving. We drove. It was a beautiful day. Glorious day. The peace of God was with us. I was driving. My mom, my kids were in the other car. We were driving. Faith. Faith, brothers. Okay. We're driving about an hour or two. The gas tank here is already halfway, Lord. But there was such a peace in me. God says, trust me, keep driving. So as I'm driving, praising God, whatnot, next thing you know, a voice came to me. He says, pull over. You're going to call your brother Juan. He's waiting. Okay, well, you know, it's not about us begging for bread because I trusted in God to see what he was going to do, but he was testing their faith. He was testing his servants. I call. Next thing you know, he's all excited, all emotional. And I said, what's going on? I said, God told me to call you. He says, you know what? I was disturbed. All I know is that I had to go in a room and pray. And I fell in the spirit and I started crying. And you guys came to me and the Lord told me to go to the Western Union and put $500 for you.
That's great. Glory!
And I said, God told me to call you, brother. He says, go pick it up. It's there. Where he told me to pull over in that gas station, there was a Western Union right inside that building.
Glory.
But not only that, because there was another two more people that he used. Two more people that he used. Because he, God brought us here in 4 days. Hotel, food, and gas he provided. But this is the way God brought us here. When we came here by faith, then the number seven was with us. He first placed us at this church over here in Liberty. The church was 7707 Church Road. The house that we got, God gave us, it was 7700 Terrace.
That's great.
We didn't have no money either to move in for that house. The man that owned that house, it was paid off. He owned it. And he said to us, I know you guys just got here. You know what? Get a job and everything later on. You just give me the rest. Don't worry about it. The only thing we had was $300 to give him to move in. That was it. But this is where God started using me. This is where he started moving me. When he said he was going to provide and bless us, that's what he started doing. When we went to that church and I started praying for people and laying hands, people being healed, people was getting jumping out of their wheelchairs. And people would come up to us, brothers and sisters, and they would put papers in my suit. Oh, here, brother, God bless you, God bless you, God bless you. Don't look at it until you get home. But you know us, we're so cute. Hey, I got to go to the bathroom, I'll be back.
Wow.
There we go, right? Ooh, thank you, God. But you know what, that's how God started blessing. We open our mailbox, and all we get is letters, no names. Thank you for your prayer, thank you for the healing. Thank God for this, thank God for that. We'll open them. $300, $400, $200. Just money. Money, money, money rolling in. But you know what? That money was God, so I was investing it back to the kingdom of God. I didn't take advantage of the money because it was his, not mine. So that's also, he would test us in that. See what you're going to do with this. Why you think he's, oh, Lord, bless me with the power bar and I will. You know what? He knows our heart. Are we really going to give what we need to give? So, you know, we have to stand by faith. And we have to love God with everything to really, you know what? That $1 million doesn't mean nothing to me. But if that $1 million is going to be invested completely to the glory of God, it's going to be sowed into there. That's what we have to discern through our spirit. We have to discern through our hearts to make sure where our finances go. But just one more... What time is it? Okay. Just one more testimony here that I have, and then I'm going to close it. But God, ever since he brought me here, God has opened my eyes in a lot of ways. When I first came here 3 years ago, the only thing I seen when I walked in this church was fire coming out of the ceilings. Fire. And then when the pastor there would minister his word, I'm telling you, we get so caught up and so used to at other churches that, okay, we 20 more minutes, we'll get you out of here, 20 more minutes. It took me a little time here when we're sitting here because the Word of God, it's about the Word of God. It's about to live with the Word of God. Not just to have a little cookie and send you home. You know, hey.
That boy, you're really preaching that. Preaching!
You know, like Pastor said, let us... Let us stick to the ribs. We want meat, not a cookie. And when I came here, let me tell you, the word really started in here. And this is what we have to do. We have to search this first, and we have to get that word in us. And we're all gifted. We're all gifted. You got gifted when you accepted God. He activated that gift. We all learn how to ride the bike. First time as we're kids, we got to keep pedaling. So you just got to get used to it and keep going forward. But rainbows, I'm telling you, I see rainbows all the time in here. I see rainbows over you guys when God's getting ready to provide. He's getting ready to bless and move you. Just the promises that he's spoken over you. It's not about what he can do or what he can give you, but it's what we can do for his glory. Because that's important, is to feel his glory. That's why he has us here. Don't be afraid to open your mouths wherever you're at. I've been in jail for that. For giving out tracts and talking to people where I'm not supposed to. But hey, you know what? I'm doing it for God. And even when he took me to jail because of that, guess what? 3-4 more souls got saved in jail. I didn't even need to go to court. Because I opened the Word of God, and God said in the Word of God, it says, I already sent an angel to unlock the prison walls, the doors. And I said, you know what? I said, brothers and sisters, my brothers, thank God, because you're going home, you're going home, you're going home. And this is going to be, this is going to be a sign. It's going to be a sign that you guys are going home, because I'm not even going to court. They're just going to call me, and I'm walking out of here. As soon as I said those words, guess what? Mr. Martinez, go home. It was just, go home. So, God is good. I mean, I don't worry about anymore where I go, where he's, you know, the devil thinks he's smart, but he's not. Because God will place us exactly where they're hungry is at, and the broken is at. And that's where we need to be at. If I can't enter the right way through the system, then he's going to bring me in the other way, though. But you know what? At least everything's in control. He has it. He's going to let me out when he's ready. I'm not afraid of that anymore. Because you know what? I know that God is with us. I know we walk under his power and under his authority. You know, God speaks and he says, why prepare the table before the presence of your enemies? Walk with that. Step on your enemy. We get together. We pray here. We get the devil, we give him 3-4 black eyes, and send him back to the pits of hell. But anyways, I just want to close it up. That was my testimony. Let's just say, let me correct this. This is God's testimony. Because if it wasn't for God, I would not be in here changed. I would not be alive. I would be... We all know this place, hell. And it's real, guys. So stay strong. You know, what is the least people can tell you? If, hey, you know what? Jesus loves you. Let me tell you. No, no, thank you. That's out of your hands. It's out of your hands. But let me go ahead and pass it on to Pastor Bill over here. And well, let's just close it up with a prayer here. And... Heavenly Father, we just come today in the name of Jesus, Almighty God. We thank you, Lord Father, for everything, because this is your testimony, this is your ministry, this is your church, these are your children, Lord. Nothing belongs to us, because we came to this world with nothing, and we will leave with nothing. But Lord Father, we just ask you today that you will continue to fill our hearts, our minds, our soul with love, joy, and peace. Father, provide for those that are in need, Almighty God. In the name of Jesus, I release the blessings upon them, Almighty God, and the joy, and the love, and the peace upon them, Almighty God. In Jesus' name, I just place everything in the palm of your hands tonight. We love you, and we thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Yeah.